The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and night to night declares knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words, their voice is not heard. Yet their voice goes out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. The glory of God echoes throughout the world. Let us praise the name of the Lord.
Turn now our attention to confession, where we confess our sins before the Lord, where we tell him we're sorry, and where we hear good news. The light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. Let us confess our sin to God.
Thank you.
Would you please bow your heads? We want to invite you into a time of silent confession where you talk to God. Would you please do that now as we enter into silence? God of grace, you have given us Jesus, the light of the world, but we choose darkness and cling to things that hide the brightness of your love. Immersed in ourselves, we have not risen to new life. Baptize us with your Spirit, that forgiven and renewed, we may preach your word to the nations and tell of your glory shining in the face of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our light forever. Amen. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his son cleanses us from all sin. Hallelujah and amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you. Would you turn to one another and share that peace? I always hate to break up your time of fellowship. I apologize. But maybe after the service, linger and get a cup of coffee and keep saying hello to one another. It's time for a scripture reading. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 10, page 1797 in your pew Bible. Lord Jesus, would you bless the reading and hearing of your word? Amen. Therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For we do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning, folks. Most of you guys know me, but should you not know me, my name is Doug Meikle, and I'm an elder here at this church, but I'm preaching today particularly because I think mostly because Jim Bursley was on vacation last week and they needed someone else to do the preaching today, right? So there is that. Another element is that later this afternoon I'm going to be ordained and installed here as the pastor for Faith and Work. And we'll talk a bit more about that as we go forward. I was a bit of an emotional wreck doing this sermon at 8:15, so you need to hope that that's all gone now, and you will get a something where I fight my way through to the end without being as much of a blubbering mess. So be praying for me as you go forward. Because I'm going to preach today, I asked Karen, my wife, said, "What should I preach on today?" She said, "You should preach on your verse. So that's what you're going to hear from me this morning. You're also going to hear kind of a theme of preparedness and how God uses the passing of time to prepare us and fit us for heaven, as it says, in a way in a manger. And because I'm kind of dyed-in-the-wool Presbyterian, you'll get a couple of main points and you'll get a conclusion, because so we don't want to wander too far away from tradition and all that good stuff. So I'm going to talk about the personal and the present and also St. Paul in the past, and then turn a little bit towards the future that I think God has called me to and its relevance for you as a congregation. But first then, the personal and the present. So I said to you, you were going to hear from me today, preaching around this my verse, should it? It's done. It's 2 Corinthians 4:7. 2 Corinthians 4:7. But we know this treasure is. We have this treasure in jars of clay, to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. Now, as I've gone through my life, I've returned to that verse many, many times. And it's moved on, I think, in how it affects me from really something that I sought to attain to more an explanation of what living as a sinful person amongst other sinners in a broken world is really like. So it's moved more than from something I would seek to attain to something that explains the limitations of my life and every other. Now those words first appear in my memory in the early morning hours of New Year's Day, 1982. It's a long time ago, long time ago. New Year's Eve is called Hogmanay in Scotland, and the tradition is after midnight, and I think they still do it there, is that you pick up your bottle of whiskey and you go visit your neighbor or something like that. And your neighbor would have probably more whiskey, probably, if it's Scotland, the Scotland I remember. But they have shortbread and other bits and pieces and snacks and stuff. And they call it first footing, that you go. And I was good at first footing because the tradition is what you're looking for is someone that's tall, dark, and, well, they say handsome, so maybe not so much me for that. But anyway, I was the right kind of size to be a good first footing guest, yeah? But in this particular time, in my mom and dad's house was the local baker. And he was indulging, of course, in the two very important Scottish traditions at Hogmanay. The first being drinking whiskey, the second being having long, melancholic reflections on the passing of time and how bad the world is and how it's bound to get worse in the new year. Yeah. So there we were. Now, I had become a Christian earlier that year, maybe not at, but certainly inspired by the Louis Palau Crusade that was in Glasgow in the Kelvin Hall. So I had gone along there, and I didn't go down the aisle or put my hand in the air or whatever you do at the altar call. But certainly after, sometime soon after those mission meetings, I had decided that life for me was going to change. It was going to be different. I was going to follow a different path. And then in the subsequent months leading up to New Year, I'd been trying to figure out what is being a Christian mean other than just kind of showing up on a Sunday a bit more often than maybe I would have. So back to Hogmanay and our baker friend. So our baker was waxing not so quite so eloquent about how the world was going to hell in a handbasket. And normally, if you're well trained in such things, what you're supposed to do is kind of nod quietly and just let the guy run out the clock, so to speak, right? But what I did for a change is that I went and picked my newly purchased Bible. And read the passage that you had heard this morning. To my shocked parents and this baker, I told them that I was a Christian now and that life was going to change. Life was going to change. That gift that Paul speaks about was so precious. It was precious to me then, and it's become even more precious as I've gone on through life, that it was given to me and I was never, ever going to let it go. That was it. And if you're doing the math, here I am 40-odd years later, and maybe 40 or so years later, and I have not let that gift go. It's really changed my life. Really changed my life. And if I've been, you know, when we lived in the Netherlands for a time during our life, my wife and I, it was a very formative experience for us. But one of the Dutch have an expression there of what is that you live within the Dutch. When you're there, but you live within them. Yeah, you live within them. And I think it's kind of a neat expression about what it's like to be around them. You live within them. And I'm going to say to you, I have lived within the Christian community now for 40-odd years, and I can report to you that we do many, many stupid things, yeah? We are just as dumb as everybody else. Thank you. Yes, we're just as dumb as everybody else. We do stupid things, but the stupid things we do, because I'm a fool myself, the foolishness of Christians never really surprises me. What surprises me and what's noteworthy is what Christians do because they've found that little bit of light in their life. How that works out over time is for me, been incredibly moving and surprising. What does that gift do? It creates new people like me and like you. It creates new small groups, little Bible studies, churches, all the way to grand institutions. That little gift that Paul places, or that God places within that fragile jar of clay, creates whole new things around it. It's truly incredible. I'm lucky enough to be around Christians who have done all of those things, who have created these new things. It's amazing. They do it, of course, because they have been transformed. They've been transformed. And that's our first lesson this morning from this little verse, that that precious gift in the jar of clay transforms the life of those who want to live within it. You know, in our present day, there seems to be more and more the case that we think that life has this kind of inescapable arc. The idea has become popular that we are defined by and forever will be determined by our skin color, our relationships, our addictions, our sexual choices. But that, my friend, is a lie. It's a lie. It's a lie because we must always be, for Christian people, people of conversion and transformation. We are witnesses to this, of what can happen. So if you are out there, if you're sitting in the pew and you are a person, the person of kind of apathetic faith, if you're the radical atheist, if you're the person that arrived at the new year sorrowful for what did not happen, or sorrowful for what you have never had, the transformation that's possible is that tomorrow, all things can be made new because Christ has made all things new. Christ has made all things new. That's the transformation that happened in my life, the transformation that happened in many of the lives of the people sitting in this pew, the transformation that's offered to us all in this scripture. And that's the first lesson we have today, that God's story of redemption is a radical transforming power for those who want to live within it. Nothing is the same after that step is taken. So that's our first lesson on the present. For our second lesson, we've got to kind of step into the past. And we read today the portion of a letter to the church from a series of letters written to the church in Corinth, a little community in the ancient city of Corinth. Now, if you know your Bible history, you'll also know that the church was birthed into a kind of context that was pretty, where the context and the culture was kind of against faith, or certainly against this little faith. Now, you might think you live in a world that's at times violent, and it clearly is. For St. Paul and the early church, they lived in a world where the powers that be meted out arbitrary violence to them at a whim and at their will. They had to live underneath that. You live in a hyper-sexualized culture. So did Paul, especially in Corinth. They had their own version of that hyper-sexualized culture that we live in today. You might think you live in a world with lots of stupid philosophies, mostly on TikTok. And the ancient world had its people like Plato or Marcus Aurelius, but it also had apex-level weirdos like the Manichees and the Gnostics. They had their crazy people too. Yeah, they had to deal with them. Slavery was an inescapable element for Paul. So inescapable in society that no one needed to give an explanation for it. It just was. It was what the powerful did to the weak. And talking about the powerful, there were a lot of people, some people, that were incredibly wealthy in the city of Corinth or in the ancient times. But the vast majority of people endured poverty like you, it's hard for us to understand. And disease and death was part of everyday life. Why do I go on about this? Because I think it's important that we understand what was the early church set against? What were they set against? So that we might understand that we do not live in some uniquely evil time. Every church, every time, in every context, has just got to answer one question. What will the gospel mean in our day? What will it mean in our day? For those early Christians, or those early Christians, who lived in a world where Caesar had declared himself to be a god, it was pretty simple. That there would be no god other than the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. They chose not to fit in to a society governed by other gods and other systems. Which brings me to the second reason why I want to get, where I think it's good to get to know what the Christians were facing, is to recognize what I call the kind of posture of the early church towards the world. Listen carefully. Here's how Paul, listen to how he writes. Think about him in that context, and what does he say? What does he say? He says, "For God, who said, 'Let the light shine out of darkness,' made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power comes from God and not from us." Now, I have gone back to that metaphor, that treasure in a simple jar of clay, continually over my life. When I was a younger Christian, I had it all wrong. I had the whole thing completely wrong because I thought that treasure was something I had to achieve, something I had to strive for. So in lots of Bible studying, praying, and witnessing, I thought one day I would get that treasure. And as I have become older, I realized the treasure is not a prize we strive for. It's the gift we begin from. It is the gift we begin from. And all of you, mostly, I would guess, are in church on the 8th of January because you've already been given that gift. Maybe some of you guys out there, I'm converting this morning, but probably most of you folks are here because that gift has already been given to you. And the question then always comes, how then shall we live? How then shall we live? You know, it's difficult for us to just get something for free. I grew up with a father who would say, "You earned everything you get in life. You get nothing for free." Most of you guys grew up in that culture today. You've also had that culture affirmed to you in your work your entire life, that you get what you earn. You get what you work for. So the transition for all of us sometimes from earning to achieve to just simply resting and receiving is a difficult one for us. And yet that is the word of our Lord Jesus. When he says, "My burden is light," what he's actually saying is, that he gets the burden. We get the gift. We get the gift. So that gets us back to this evangelical posture of the early church. I think if we're going to say a couple of things about their practice, I think there's two things that are important. The first is, if we want to follow their practice, the first priority of evangelism is our own heart, our own formation. That's the starting point. If I was going to poll you guys and say, how long was the first century catechism class? How long did it take before they could enter into fellowship and take of the Lord's Supper? I don't know what you guys would say. Maybe there's a good historian out there that might make a good guess. 3 years was typical. Yeah? Because before those folks would let people take this transforming meal of the Lord's Supper, they had to make sure they were transformed people. Transform people. They would take them out of the culture and reculture them. Reculture them. It's incredible. They had the first priority of their evangelism was working on their own hearts. But the second thing is that when you read the Acts of the Apostles, you get the impression, and of course it's true, that the church was driven forward by the preaching and teaching of the apostles. No doubt that's true. But if you take the time to read through the Bible carefully, also read a bit of the early church history, what you see ultimately is the great evangelical power of that church was not in the arguments that it won, but it was in the lives that they lived. The lives that they lived were so radically different from the world that is around them. There's many women featured in the first in the Bible, for example, in the letters of St. Paul. That's incredibly unusual. for that ancient time. Why were women attracted to the church in the start? Because of the, basically, the sexual morals of the church. Women moved from being exploited routinely by their male partners who were more powerful to being co-partners in relationships before God. That was an immensely powerful message for them, that they moved from one power structure to another. That was the gospel practically in action in the lives of the people that practiced it day in, day out. So that's my second lesson. The evangelical power of the church lies in, not in its arguments, but in its way of life. So I suppose now in conclusion, a couple of words about the future. And I said there was a theme of preparedness, so the careful amongst you are probably wondering, when is he going to talk about preparedness? Because that's going to show up now, so don't worry, you're good. I don't tell people this too often, but when I left seminary a long time ago, I felt pretty much spiritually exhausted. I also felt entirely unprepared for what God would call me to next. I had the choice of three things to do. I could go be the associate pastor in my wife's hometown, or I'd got accepted at a PhD program in Jackson, Mississippi, so that's a whole other story for another day. And the third is come be an engineer in Houston. And essentially what I did was I ran away to Houston to be an engineer and just hide from the world a little bit, hoping to recover. But God had good things in store for me. Over the years, I think what God has been able to do for me, I think, is help me understand the relevance of that passage that he laid upon my heart 40 years ago. You see, in that passage, it seems to me the truth is all there. The truth is all there. I see now that treasure of new life in Christ is the certainty of the transformation of all things. It's the certainty that the earth is the Lord's. That the Lord, that's not just a random throwaway statement. It's a statement of fact, and it's a statement that we can depend on in eternity. That this earth is the Lord's. Once you see that, there's no way of turning back. No way of turning back. The jar of clay is us, the malleable, formable people, able to be made fit for heaven over the passing of time. Your time here on this earth is for those who choose to live within the story of God's redemptive purpose, the time God gives you to prepare you for heaven. Every moment, every day, you're being shaped more and more that in eternity you may be with him. That, my friend, is a gift worth having, a gift worth having. But when you think of the future, there's probably only one thing that we can truly guarantee, that there will be tough times ahead sometimes, and even hardships. You know, the other night, I was having dinner with my kids. It was Karen's birthday, so Karen and I and the kids were having dinner. And I was kind of struck by the basic pessimism of my kids. And forgive me, I know there's two of them out there, or three of them. They can correct the record later. They can correct the record later. But I was kind of struck by their pessimism to think, you guys, you know, you old people, that'd be me, you've just consumed all the world's resources and stuck us with a bill, yeah? And, you know, I don't want to get myself completely off the hook for that because there's a lot of truth in that. Have we given to our children a world better than we inherited from our parents? I'm not so sure we can say yes to that. And it will be up to them to do something with the world that we hand to them. But on the other hand, you point to a passage like this and how Paul concludes it is, you know, we are not struck down, not in despair, not abandoned, because we carry around in our body the very life of Christ. The very life of Christ. Before he speaks about that, though, he talks about the death of Christ, reminding us that the world is not how it is supposed to be. That the world that we, there will always be less than our expectations of it because it's broken. And this, we're not in heaven yet. We're going to have to work to change it, to build it, to shape it, to allow it as us to enjoy its eternity with God in its midst. So today, I'm going to be installed and ordained as a pastor of faith and work. And it's sort of a trendy title in the church world, so there you are. I'm on trend, as my kids would say. But you might, or maybe they wouldn't say that, yes, but I'll leave that alone. But you might wonder what that is or what will I do? And I think practically, just to close the sermon, I've got two things that I'd say in response to that. Practically, I think there's two things I need to do, or two things that's worth saying. At its most basic level, it means that I, along with the other members of the FBC staff, we're sort of in the conversion business. And it may well be, because we are fools and sinners, we've ruined that word with our false promises and our false lives. But in the end, I don't have a better word for you. Because it's the only word that seems to capture the radical change in life that the gospel demands of us. And the gospel empowers in us. I think that's maybe the only word that describes it. So we're in the conversion business. But specifically, you know, once that's happened, what do we do next? And I think the short answer to that is to the ministry that First Pres has helped us found, this new ministry called True Works. What do we do in there? We try and form good people and good ventures. And in doing this, we're trying to help faithful Christians live faithfully. Live faithfully. And bring to life that evangelical power of the church. Because I am completely convinced by this, that the evangelical superpower is in the life we live. It's in the homes and children we create. It's in the work we do, the investments that we make. Our lives together with each other is a powerful call to the sinner to repentance. That's the classic old-timey word. But what does that mean? It means folks out there leaving that life where they're building something for themselves to enter this life where they're building a kingdom that Christ will come back to share with us. That's what I want. That's what I want. So in the end, my calling is your calling. Jesus inaugurated this kingdom. Now we proclaim it and build it with his help. And you know, last word for me in my final 32 seconds is that I'm blessed to see this work up close and personal. This weekend is also the middle retreat of our Main Street Fellowship that we teach here at church. And it's an awesome thing to watch people enter that program with this thirst for a faith that touches and forms their whole life. And begin to walk away knowing that those deep wells of our Christian faith, in them is a draft that will satisfy their every thirst. Ultimately, that is what we offer to you as you come here week by week, day by day, hour by hour. That this gift, this transforming power that Paul speaks of, is the gift that Christ gives us. It's only up to you now to respond. That is my calling. To God be the glory. Amen.
Thank you.
Please remain standing and let's affirm our faith together by reciting the Apostles' Creed. Followers of Jesus, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And let us pray. And so, Lord God, we respond to this good word from your word by Doug with help. We need your help. In order to become this type of person that he described through your word, in order to live like this, we need your help. Would you awaken us? Would you help us come out of our slumber, our spiritual sleepiness, that we would be convinced that your word is true, that you are right now preparing us for something, that you right now are longing for us to live in the light of Jesus, that you right now are asking us to give more of ourselves to you. And so we need your help. There are so many things that distract us, that are obstacles, that are roadblocks. Would you remove them? Give us perseverance and energy to live the life you want us to live. Lord Jesus, thank you that you consider us your treasure in broken pots. We all struggle, we all sin, we all fail, and yet you pick us up. You say that we are yours, a holy people, holy and dearly loved by the great high God. So would you help us to wake up today and every day to what you're doing around us and in us, that we could live our lives, everything that we do, day by day, moment by moment, for you. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I feel compelled to ask you this question. What is the next step of obedience to Jesus that he is calling you into? Perhaps it's something here in this congregation. Perhaps it's signing up for the prayer course that Pastor Caitlin talked about a week ago. You can join a small group. You can do it on your own. It's an 8-week course online that the speaker gets into the Lord's Prayer. Perhaps the Lord is calling you to grow in your prayer life. Perhaps he is calling you to come to the marriage conference in a couple weeks. That's with Jim Singleton, who is a friend of this congregation. He's been here many, many times. He and his wife have been married
40-plus years, and they'll be leading us in a marriage conference. We'd love for you to come back for that. Perhaps the Lord is calling you to come back today at 4 o'clock to be witnessed to a new leader who is here but having a new calling in his life, Doug's ordination. It's amazing to watch other leaders lay hands on one of their own into special service to God. Doug, as he mentioned, will be an assistant pastor in an FPC-validated ministry of True Works. I think that was correct in what I just said. But please come back, and there will be great food after the service. So think of ways to not only jump into the life of this congregation, but also frame it up as what is the next step in my obedience to Jesus. As the ushers come forward, we respond now with our gifts. If God has so freely given to us, we simply give back. Thank you for your generosity to this congregation. Know that as you give, it is also your spiritual act of worship to Him. We continue in worship.
So, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ, and has given us this ministry of reconciliation. Go in peace in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.